In this lab exercise, we're going to begin looking at the modern digital design flow, meaning that we are going to model a logic circuit in VHDL and then allow a CAD tool to actually perform the synthesis and technology mapping and place and route for us. And what we're going to do is we will then download that onto a programmable logic device, which will use a field programmable gate array for, so an FPGA, which is one of the most common programmable logic devices out there. And the objective here is we are going to create a four-input prime number detector. Okay, so before we've done a prime number detector, but we only had three inputs, and that was to kind of get experience building circuits with discrete logic. Now what we're going to do is expand the size of the circuitry to look at four inputs. So we'll look at numbers between 0 and 15 decimal, and the circuit will be much larger, but we're going to model it in VHDL, which will allow us to create kind of an abstract description of it. So after this lab, what you'll be able to do is use a tool called Cortus in order to perform the synthesis of your design and download it and test it on an FPGA. And what we're going to do is we'll use the DE0CV FPGA board that's in your lab kit, and we'll also get experience interfacing that FPGA board to your breadboard. Okay, so we'll get power from the FPGA board, we'll pass a signal over to your breadboard, and so we'll look at the interfacing of that. So what you're going to need for this lab is your breadboard and wires. You want your LED driver circuit from your prior lab, because we'll observe the output of the prime number detector on an LED. On your breadboard. We want the buzzer circuit from a prior lab, because we'll also just have the output of the detector assert that also, so we'll just jumper a wire over there. You need your DE0CV FPGA board, so that's the big FPGA box that's in your kit, and you need a USB cable that comes with it. Note that we're going to get all the power from the USB cable. So when you open that box, you'll see that there's a AC adapter in there that you can plug into the wall. You do not need that. All of the designs we're going to use, or that we do in this in these exercises, are small enough that they don't consume enough power that you need that AC adapter. We can use the power from USB, which makes it very nice. And then we're going to interface the FPGA board to our breadboard using three female-to-female jumper wires. Okay. So when we start to build this, we're going to break the design up into multiple pieces. So the first thing we're going to do is we're just going to get a simple VHDL design implemented on the FPGA. So we'll write some VHDL that'll basically just take some switches on the board and drive them to the LEDs, just to make sure we know how to start a project and get all the drivers set up and everything's good. And then once we get that working, then we will actually connect it to the FPGA or to the breadboard and then implement the prime number detector. So we'll kind of break the design up just to ensure that we don't have to debug too much at once. Okay, so here's the task. We are going to build a prime number detector. We're going from 0000 to 1111, and so what that means is we want a combinational logic circuit that asserts whenever you see a 2 decimal, 3, 5, 7, 11, and 13. Okay, so it's the 11 and 13 which are new by looking at four inputs. Okay, and we are actually going to look at interface the FPGA board to our breadboard. We're actually going to use it to provide power. So you will not be using the analog discovery in this lab. The 3.4 volts and ground from the FPGA board, we will wire those into our breadboard, and that will power everything on our breadboard. So we don't need any other power supply. Okay. All right. So here is kind of the block diagram of what we're going to be doing today. On the left, you'll see a box that represents the DE0CV board. Okay. On that is a programmable logic device, this FPGA. So that's the big chip on there. And it's a Cyclone 5 FPGA. And this just has an abundance of programmable logic resources that we can download our VHDL design into, and we can test it. It allows you to actually assign the ports of your entity to pins. So it's a very flexible device. On that board is a bunch of I/O, so general purpose I/O, such as switches and LEDs and connectors, and there's buttons, and you can kind of look at it and you can see all these different things that are on it. What we're going to use for this exercise is we're going to bring in the four inputs to the prime number detector from four slider switches on there, and they're labeled SW3, 2, 1, and 0. And we'll bring those into the FPGA. They're already wired up. We just need to know what pins they're on. And then we're going to drive those back directly to some red LEDs that are on the board also. And those are already wired up too. We just got to know what pins to program them to. And so the first part is we're just going to make sure we can switch the switches and have them show up on the red LEDs. And that'll show us that we've built the right project, we have everything set up. Then for the second part, what we're going to do is we're going to make the prime number detector, and we'll drive it out on an output called prime. And it comes out on a pin that's wired to pin 2 of this GPIO connector. And this connector is just a bunch of 10th inch pin headers. And it's kind of nice because we can program an output to come here, and then we'll just jumper wire it over to the breadboard, and the output of the prime number detector, we'll route that to one of the LEDs in our LED driver, and we'll also just jumper it over to the buzzer so that it buzzes when there's a prime number. And then we need to have these two boards be on the same level so that they can pass digital signals back and forth. So to do that, we want the power and ground to be common between them. So we can grab the ground of the FPGA board on pin 30 of this connector and jumper wire it over into the rails of our breadboard, and then we'll grab plus 3.4 from this connector and bring that over and put that in the power rails of our board. This 3.4 right here is actually, it's regulated on this FPGA board, so it's really nice. It brings in the voltage from the USB, which is 5 volts, and it's got this internal signal which will produce this 3.4 volts, and we can use that to power other stuff. In this situation, the stuff is our breadboard. Okay, here's what the picture of it looks like. So notice that I've got my FPGA board over here, the switches are down here, and they're being displayed on the red LEDs, which are right above them. And then I've got little jumper wires that I jumper wire over the prime output, and it's on this is GPIO_1, the big connector. And these pins on here are wired to pins of this FPGA, and so we get to choose which outputs go to which pin, and we'll tell it to come out on pin 2 over here. And then what we do is we have our ground and our power, which are jumpered over here, and you can see that they go right into the power rails. Okay. All right, so let's begin. First thing we want to do is create a design that just takes the switches and drives them back to the LEDs. So for this first part, don't connect your board yet. Okay, we just want to get this FPGA board up and running. Don't even turn it on yet. Okay, leave the breadboard disconnected and don't plug in the USB cable yet. So we'll get everything started, and then we'll turn it on. Okay, so first thing that you have to do is install the Cordis Lite software. I'm going to assume that it's already been installed just to save time in this video, but here are instructions on how to install it. Okay, you go out and you want to get this Cordis Lite software. It is a free version that's provided by a company called Altera, they make the FPGAs, but they were recently purchased by Intel, and so when you go to this website, it redirects you to Intel. But the instructions will walk you through how to get the free version, and then you also get the drivers for the Cyclone 5 family, okay, so that you can talk to that board. Okay, so I'll assume that you've done that. Okay, now here's how we're going to organize things. We need to make a folder, and this folder will hold all of our VHDL projects, or all of our Cordis projects would be a better way of saying it. Cordis is the name of the software that we use to synthesize our VHDL. Okay, so remember, we're synthesizing now. We are not simulating. We are actually going to make a model and run a synthesis tool, and it's going to create the actual logic circuits for us that can be downloaded onto the chip. Okay, so in order to keep everything organized, we're going to make one folder called Logic Lab, and we'll put it on the desktop of our computer. And then for each project, so this will be one project, this exercise 5.1, we will make a folder for it, and so everything will be organized in folders. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go File New Folder, and I'm going to name it Logic Lab, and this is happening kind of off to the left of your screen, so I'll go Logic Lab. Okay, and then I open that guy up, and here's what I see. I've got, this is Windows Explorer, and I'm just looking at this, and you can see that it's on my desktop, and it's called Logic Lab. And the first thing we want to do is go ahead and make a new folder under it, which is going to be this lab exercise. So what we want to do is we want to call it something descriptive, and what I'd like you to do is name it the same thing that's in this handout, so that all of the everything that I'm talking about makes sense. Okay, so I'm gonna name it lab_05p1. The P stands for point, and then I'll go _prime_num_detdetdetect. Okay, so I have my folder, and when we launch Cordis, we'll tell it put the project in this folder. Okay, all right, now we're ready to launch Cordis. So under start, depending on what Windows you have, I have Windows 10, so it's going to be start, all programs, and then you go to Intel, it's called Intel FPGA, and then you'll see Cortus. Okay, so Cortus comes up, and this is the blank project window right there. Okay, so now we're sitting here, and we're ready to get going. When we create a project from scratch, what we want to do is it's easiest to use the new project wizard. So go ahead and click new project window, new project wizard. And here comes a bunch of screens that'll help you get set up. So it says introduction, you're going to start a new project. We say next. This is critical, this directory and name. This is where you tell it where to put the project and what to call it. So what I'm going to do is I hit browse on where to put the working directory, and I want to come up to my desktop, which is desktop. And then I'm going to go into Logic Lab, and then here's the folder I just created. Double click on that, select the folder. The name of the project, good practice is name the project something descriptive. The project name is just the Cortus project, okay? It's not the VHDL files. So I'm going to call this lab0_05p1_primedet for detect. This is the name of the project. Here is a critical thing. All three of these are critical. The name of the top level design is the top level entity. So this is the top VHDL file in your system. You do not want to call it this. You want to call it always top. Okay, top is going to be top.vhd, and top is the standard naming convention for the VHDL file in one of these real designs that is at the highest level of hierarchy. And so it is the very topmost part or topmost level, and its ports, okay, are actual pins of the device. So when you have top, I mean, if you have an output port, it needs to be wired to an actual pin. Okay, so if you're not named top, that means you're usually a subsystem which is being called to implement some functionality. The danger here is that when you type in the name of the project, Cortus automatically populates it down here, and you don't want that. Okay, so I always give a descriptive name for the project, and then I call this top. So very important. Then you hit next. We want an empty project this time. Add files. If you happen to have existing VHDL files that you were going to include as a component, you could put them in here. You could add them, but we are not going to have any files. The top.vhd, we're going to create it from scratch within Cortus, so we don't have any existing files. Okay, then you come to this family device and board settings. Now, this is where you tell Cortus, what are you synthesizing for? What is the technology you're going to have? So the family is called Cyclone 5, so Cyclone V. And if you only downloaded the Cyclone 5 drivers like I have in the instructions, what you're going to see is you only have one family in here, but you can have all the families that are supported by Altera in here. Right here, you only see that we have one. But under that family, there's a ton of different FPGAs. So if you come down here, I mean, you got dozens and dozens of different FPGAs. The way that you can filter it down is you can actually start typing in this filter box, and it will start removing options from down here. So the FPGA that we want, its part number is 5CEBA. And you can see this, it's on the part itself. So if you look at the actual FPGA, you can see these numbers. So we got 5CEBA, 4F. And notice as I'm typing, the list is getting smaller and smaller. And then we're in a 23C7. Okay, so once I get all that typed in there, there's only one device left, and that's it. So that's what we want. So you highlight it and hit next. EDA tool settings, we're not going to use any third-party tools, so go ahead and just leave that blank and say next. And now you get to the summary. Here's what you want to check. Make sure your project directory is correct. Make sure the project name is something descriptive. And make sure you name the top-level design entity top. Very important. Then make sure that you chose the right device, 5CEBA4F23C7, which is, it's in the handout. Okay, I'm ready, and I hit finish, and now this is gonna work for a second. So it says, please wait while Cortus Prime opens this thing. And this, it's taking a second because it's pulling all the information on the technology into the project, and so that when you synthesize it, it knows what type of AND gates and D flip-flops and all that sort of stuff are in there. Here we are, we now have a blank project, and we're ready to start with our first, you know, design, okay? Right now there are no VHDL files, but we want to add one, and the one we want to add is we want to create this thing called top.vhd. So if you come over and go File, New, it will bring up this window that says what type of new file you want. Under Design Files, go down and click VHDL file and say OK. It creates one with a .vhd extension, which is what we want, and it's blank, okay? So what I'm gonna do is, the first thing I wanna do is go File, Save As, and let's name it top.vhd. Now it puts it in the default location, and it names it top.vhd because we don't have, the name of your design entity is top, and it doesn't have a top, so it's like, you obviously must be trying to create top, so it's gonna put top in here. So the first time through this, you just hit Save, and you're off and running. So now see that it's top.vhd. If I type in here, you'll see an asterisk on the tab, and that means it hasn't been saved. So if you hit the save button, the asterisk goes away. So we've now created top.vhd, and it's time to start adding the entity. Okay, so let's take a look at the entity itself, and the entity, if you recall, is the ports. So what ports do we need for this design? Well, what we need are nine pins, which come in the form of three different ports. So we're going to have a port which is going to be called SW, which stands for the switches, and I name it that because that's what the labels are on the board. So I'm going to have a vector which is going to be SW3 down to 0, and it's a 4-bit vector. And it's going to be used to bring in the four slider switches on the FPGA board. We're also going to have an LEDR vector, which is 4 bits wide, and those are going to be the red LEDs, and that's what they're labeled on the board. So that'll be LEDR 0, 1, 2, and then we're going to have one output which is called prime, and prime is going to be the output of the prime number detector, and that's what we'll route over to the connector, and then we'll jumper wire it onto the breadboard. Here's what the entity should look like. Okay, so for this first one, I'm going to give you everything you need to be successful. It's because the first time through this, you want to make sure you don't get off in the weeds. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to have an entity called top, and then I'm going to have my three ports, and two of them are 4-bit vectors, and one of them is a 1-bit vector, and that will be the inputs and outputs of this design. Okay, so when I come into here, let's go ahead and enter this. So I'm going to go entity, and one of the things I notice is that, like, I'm typing right here and it doesn't show up. This is just kind of like a bug that you run into sometimes. If I save this and then close it, and to open it again, I double click over here, it seems like the first time sometimes it has an issue displaying things, and after that you're good. So let's go entity, top is, and let's go port, and then we'll have switch, and its mode is in, and then it's type bit vector 3 down to 0, and let me spread this window out a little bit so you can see all the VHDL. All right, and then we're going to have our second output port, which is going to be called LEDR, and it is mode out type bit vector, and it's 3 down to 0. And then finally, we're going to have prime, and prime is an output, but it's a single bit, and then that's the end of my entity. So end of T, and I'm done. Okay, so now I'm going to line these up a little bit, make it look a little bit cleaner, and there is my entity. Let me go ahead and save that, and now I'm ready for my architecture. Now the architecture that we want to implement is nothing more than driving the switches to the LEDs. So let me create an architecture called top_arc of top is, and I'll go begin, and then I'm going to come down here and go end architecture, and now here's my functionality. I can drive the switches to the LEDs with one single concurrent signal assignment. So I'm just going to go LEDR gets assigned switch. Since they're both 4-bit vectors, this assignment will automatically handle, you know, bit 3 gets bit 3, bit 2 gets bit 2, etc. So that's all the functionality that I need in order to implement driving the switches to the LEDs on the FPGA board. I'm going to save this up, and now I'm going to run my first compile. And actually, it's more than a compile, it's a synthesis. If you look over at how you run things in Quartus, you come over here into this task pane, and it lists all the tasks that you need to complete. Compile design is the big one. If you double click on this, it'll run compile design, and the way that it's built is everything underneath it will be run. So we want to get to the point where everything has been synthesized and placed in route, and we get to the point where we have a file that we actually download to the FPGA. But it's going to take a couple steps because we're going to run this first and get it synthesized without assigning the pins. So then once we have everything clean, then we'll go assign the pins. So if I click compile design, it's going to launch the compiler and the synthesizer. So the first thing that it does is analysis and synthesis. So it's not much to synthesize, but it still has to technology map it into the Cyclone 5 FPGA that we're using. So it's going to check your syntax for your VHDL, and the first thing that'll happen is if you had an error, like if you forgot a semicolon or something, it will put an error down here in red, and it'll tell you what line you're at, and it's just like any compiler. You double click on it and it'll show you where it is, and so that's where you get your syntax errors. But it's doing a whole lot more. It's doing synthesis, so it's taking logic and trying to map it into, or it's trying to figure out what the actual logic gates are, and then it does a place and route, and that's where it takes the logic circuit it came up with, and it tries to place it into the available logic gates on this FPGA. So this Cyclone 5 has just, you know, 100,000 gates that you can map it into, and so it maps it into there and fits it, and then it routes all the connections together. And then it starts doing these other things which allow you to create the actual file that downloads to the FPGA. And as these complete successfully, they turn green, and the goal is to get everything to turn green here. And so we're 99%. Okay, so I just completed. So life is good, everything is great. You get a ton of warnings, but they're usually timing warnings, which we don't worry about in most of these labs. So don't worry about the warnings, that the errors are what are killer. Okay, so now I have this and I'm good to go. But I haven't assigned the pins yet. So I had to do that compile step in order for Cortus to understand what the ports are. So the next thing I want to do is assign the pins. So I'm going to go assignments, pin planner, and a graphical window is going to come up that has a picture of the FPGA. So these are all the available I/O that a user can use, and they've got all different types, and you can kind of see what's what. But more importantly, if I come down here to this window and make it a little bit bigger, it has all of the pins or the ports that were in my entity. And I had to compile to get them over here, but there they are. So you see that there's 4 bits that are LEDR and 4 bits that are switch. The reason that they're broken out as individual bits is because each of those needs to go to a pin. Okay? So now we know where we want these to go pin-wise, but the actual pin name itself, you go into the user's manual, and it'll tell you where the LEDs are, where the switches are, where this particular pin of the GPIO is. But I went ahead and pulled them out for you. So here's the way we want to assign this. We want LED3 to be on Y3, W2, et cetera, et cetera. But the way that you name them is you have to put capital PIN underscore before the actual location number. Okay? So we're just going to type these in, and the way you can do it, if you want to do it into location, but pay attention to this. When you compile for the first time and you don't have pin locations, it will automatically assign you some just based upon where it thinks that they might go best. So it'll have a fitter location, and you don't want any of these are the default ones, and they aren't correct. Okay, they're just its first attempt at it. So let's go ahead, and we want to make sure that we have something in location. So I double click in here and I can type pin underscore Y3, but I could also use the drop down menu. Now the drop down menu is massive, so sometimes it's easier just to type them in, but you can enter the pins either way. So it doesn't take too long with this number of pins, and just underscore A1, and then, because you only have 9 of them, pin underscore A2, pin underscore A12, and when you have massive designs that have like 100 or 1,000 inputs, what you can do is put them in a spreadsheet, and then you can import them in here. But for this one, we can actually enter them in here pretty quickly. So I am ready to pin underscore U13. So now let me check these. So LED3210 is Y3, W2, AA1, AA2, and then A12, and then we got T12, T13, V13, U13. Okay, so I've got all the pins assigned. The other thing that we need to do is change the output logic level for prime. So now prime is going to go to our breadboard, and our breadboard is going to run off a 3.3 volt CMOS. So what I need to do is it defaulted to a 2.5 volt IO standard. So I want to change that to be 3.3 CMOS. So I use this drop down menu, and I can actually change its logic level. So I just changed it to 3.3 volt CMOS. And then the current strength for default, I want to change that to maximum. So I want to have enough current to drive that LED on my breadboard. All the other ones are actually internal signals to the FPGA board. So they're 2.5 volts, but they're talking to each other. So it doesn't matter. That works. So the FPGA will understand the 2.5 volt logic. So I can leave those the same. There's no save on this. What you do is you just go file, close, and then those pin assignments will take. And now what happens is that our compiler tasks have all turned into yellow again or brown, and that's because we have changed the design. So now what we have to do is recompile it. And now when it recompiles it, it'll come up with the same logic, but this time it's going to assign it to those pins. And when we get done with this part, now we'll have an actual file that we can use to download to the FPGA and test it. Okay, so now we're done compiling, and notice everything's green again, and we're ready to do a program device. Okay, so we're going to go ahead, and at this point, we want to turn on the FPGA. Okay, so now I'm going to show you, here's my FPGA and FPGA board, and here's my breadboard, but I don't have them connected yet. Okay, so I don't have them wired. This right here, I've plugged it into my USB cable, and I'm going to turn the power on to it by pressing the red button. Okay, so now, by default, when you get this out of the box, it already has an FPGA program in it, and it lights up some I.O. And that program is actually stored in a double EEPROM, and it boots up every single time. What we do is we come in the back door, and we're going to overwrite that with our own program. So this is kind of neat to leave that on there. We'll never overwrite the double EEPROM in what we do. We just want to test our designs. Okay, so now here's what we got to do. Let's open up Program Device by double-clicking on it. If you have version 17 or greater of Cordis, it will automatically go out and find any FPGA device that is a 5CEBA4F23, and it'll go ahead and initialize it, and it'll put it in this chain right here. The output file that we've generated through this entire synthesis process is called top.sof, and it's stored in a folder called output files. Okay, so what we want to do here is all I'm going to do is hit start, and it is going to download it. If this is the first time that you've run Cordis, usually the USB blaster driver, which is the driver for the FPGA board, is not selected. So what you do is you come into hardware setup, and under here it'll have no hardware is usually what the default is when you first install Cordis. What you want to do is just choose USB blaster, so that this has to be USB blaster. If this doesn't find it right here, like in earlier versions in 17, it wouldn't find it. You have to actually go in here and do auto detect, and it'll go out and find that FPGA. And then you have to browse to the file itself by clicking on it and then saying edit, add file. But with 17 and greater, it automatically comes up. So all I'm going to do here is hit start. And what you'll see is the progress right here. And here it goes. And it's successful. Okay. So now when I look at the FPGA, I come over here and look at what I got. I've got, you know, here's my red LEDs, and I have, you know, if I change the switches, I go, and everything's great. Okay, so everything is great. I've got my four LEDs on there, and they operate as I would suspect, and I have just done it. I've created a Cordis project from start to finish, and I've synthesized it, and I've downloaded it. So now I'm ready for the second part, which is going to be I want to connect the FPGA board to the breadboard, okay? And so when I do this, I want to make sure that my FPGA is off. So I turn that off. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use these jumper wires, these female jumper wires, and I'm going to put, you know, this. I keep calling this a 10th inch pin. It's because these are really common connectors. It's a 0.025 square mil or square inch pin, but it's on 10th of an inch pitches, so that's what these 10th inch headers is, just kind of the name that everybody uses. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect to pin 2 of GPIO1, which is this connector, and you can see the label down there. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to plug that into my breadboard, and that will be prime that comes over, and I jumper that over here that will drive this LED that sits down here, the bottom one of my LED drivers. Okay, I also go ahead and jumper that over to the buzzer so that it'll make audio. And then what I want to do is I want to grab my power and ground. And so those are up here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and it's that one right there. That's my ground. And I'll go ahead and put, I have 10th inch header pins right in there on my ground rail. And then I'll go ahead and I'll grab 3.4 volts and I'll bring that over and wire it in. So now I've interfaced my boards together, and I can, at this point, I can turn on the FPGA board. Now notice my program's gone because I power cycled, so it's running this default program again, but I should have power to my board. And if I do, I can check that by turning on these dip switches right here and making sure that the LEDs come on, which they do. Okay? All right, so I know that I have power to my board. Everything's great because I can see that, and life is good. So the board is interfaced, and now all I got to do is do this last part, which is I need to write the VHDL for the prime number detector. Okay, so to get you started, I'll give you a little. You have two techniques at your disposal at this point in this manual. You basically have concurrent signal assignments, and you have a conditional signal assignment and a selected signal assignment. Those are your best ones, okay? Those are the ones that allow you to do an abstract version. So you can assign, this is a conditional signal assignment, you do prime gets something when the input is this. So the input is SW, and I'm gonna list all 16 possible values from 0 up to 15 decimal, and then I'm gonna assign a 1 anytime that this input is a prime number. And so that is how I would do it if I did a conditional signal assignment. A selected signal assignment is the same thing, but it's just a little easier, not easier, but different syntax. You do a with, and then you put the input, and then you say select, and then you assign prime gets an output when this input code. So just a slightly different syntax. So this is two examples. They're not complete. You're going to have to type it in yourself, but just to kind of get you going. So what you want to do is you want to enter that code right here. And let's see, I'll just grab some code that I did before this and try not to give it all to you. So there you go. There's some. I did a selected signal assignment. And I'll go ahead and save this. And now I need to compile it. Let me make sure everything's good. So I've saved that, and notice everything went gray again. So I'm going to go ahead and do a compile design and let this run for a second. Okay, so now it's all compiled. And so now what we're going to do is bring the programmer back up. The programmer's, if you didn't close the window, it's ready to go. All you did is update that top.sof file. And now what I'm going to do is just hit start again. And we'll take a look. So now as it's programming, the buzzer's going off. And then we're ready. So here we are. So now let's test it. So here I've got my four inputs, and I should be able to go, there's one, and notice it lights up there. There's two, and two is a prime number. And so notice that my LED lit up over here, and the buzzer went off. And so it's like, oh, this is great. So what about three? Three is also a prime number. What about four? Four is not a prime number. And so we did it. We have our five is a prime number, six is not, seven is a prime number, but then the big ones are here's 9, 10, 11. That's 9, 10, 11. There's a prime number. Then you got 12, and then 13 is a prime, 14, 15 not. Okay? We did it. All right, now, if this doesn't work for you, here's where you start debugging, okay? Pin planner is probably where you almost always start, is you make sure that the pin planner tool has the right assignments for the output. These ones are pretty simple because they show up right away. This one, if it's dead, try the pin planner. The other thing to make sure is to make sure that you have power and ground on here, and you verify that by looking at these pins over here. So make sure you have power, and you should be able to drive your LED driver, you know, these babies over here. And then you just go through all the steps in that Cordis design flow, and you have done it. So now we're at the end of this, and so here's what you need to do. So for your deliverables, the first deliverable was taking a 2-second video of these driving the switches to the LEDs on the D0 nano or D0 CV. The second one is take a video showing the prime number detector fully, you know, interface with your breadboard. And then we also need to get a copy of the top.vhd, okay? So this file, the third requirement is actually delivering that top.vhd. So that is, where do you find that at? Well, if you go back into your folder, so under Logic Lab, here's your main folder. It's always going to be in the top, in the primary folder, primary project folder. Okay, so it's going to be top.vhd. If you don't have your file extensions on, if it doesn't understand what VHD is, it always calls it a hard disk image. But it can be confusing because there's a bunch of different things that are called top. So for example, QSF is a different file. This is a backup file. So you're always looking for the top.vhd, and you can always right click on it and say property. So to get a copy of that for your last deliverable. So you have done it. And if you think about it, after doing this exercise, could you use the modern digital design flow to take a VHDL model for a combinational logic circuit and synthesize it for implementation on an FPGA? I hope so, because you just did that. Okay. And the second thing is, can you interface an FPGA board to a breadboard to successfully transfer digital signals between the two systems? And what you're thinking about there is that the two systems have to be talking the same logic level. So they need to have the same ground, they need to have the same VCC, and then they can understand what a logic high is and what a logic low is. And that is the end of this exercise.